Hey guys, Dr. J here, and in this video, we're going to be talking about UAV mission planning. So the thing that I want you to keep in mind as we go through this video is that this presentation is going to be for doing Part 107 related flights. So not just flying for fun. So if you're not just flying for fun, there's a purpose or an objective to your mission. There's a reason that you're flying, and you want to keep that reason in mind throughout the mission, both the preparation stage, the mission itself, and then following up the mission. What's the goal in mind? What's the objective that you're trying to get? What's the data that we need to get? What sensor? Do you have a sufficient UAS to carry out the mission? Who are the people, the stakeholders in the mission that need the results? Is it yourself? Is it someone else? So this includes things like what is wanted versus what is needed. What's the ideal versus what's been promised? What can be accomplished with the equipment that's available at the moment? In some cases, you may have trade-offs, and we've talked about trade-offs in other videos, where maybe, yes, getting more photos is going to give you a better resolution, better accuracy, but maybe it's going to take quite a bit more processing time and quite a bit more money as a result, and so you don't necessarily want to go down that route. So there's a trade-off. Basically, you want to get as high accuracy, as high resolution as possible, while not having too large of data sets, maybe if you have a client, that will be too big for them to deal with, maybe if it's going to take too much processing time. So there's these trade-offs that we have to keep in mind whenever we're doing a project. And again, it's going to come back to those objectives. That's why it's important to define those right from the get-go. So as you're site planning, as you're preparing for the type of UAV that you need to fly, the type of sensor that you have, whether or not you can meet those requirements, you are able to think about the resolution that you'll be needing, the limitations of the data type. If you want to fly photogrammetry over an area that's forested, is that going to be good enough? Or do you need to have a LiDAR sensor, for example? So all of these things are going to come into play. So I've got one particular sensor which has a multispectral, I think four or five multispectral bands. It's got an optical sensor, it's got a thermal sensor. That's a really great sensor to be able to use and to be able to acquire good data with. But most sensors are going to only have one type of sensor. So whether that's optical, maybe it's a multispectral, so you've got several bands, maybe it's a thermal. Those are going to be the most common type of sensor that you come across. And the terrain that you're going to fly over, and that coupled with your objective, is going to have a big impact on which sensor that you'll need. So obviously, when we're planning for our mission, there's going to be basic things that we need to define. We need to find the area of interest. Where are we going to fly? We need to define the coordinate system of the data that we're going to come, that is going to be the final product. So if we are looking for a construction site, they're most likely going to need things in a local coordinate system, maybe a state plane. If we're doing data for doing scientific analysis, probably we want that in a global coordinate system. I've done a project where I was flying LiDAR data at several different locations, and I wanted to be able to tie all those locations and several flights actually at each location together in the same coordinate system. So in that case, I was using a global coordinate system. But if you were going to take that data and then do something with it on a local scale, you might need to do a transformation, or we might need to fly a different coordinate system. GCPs is obviously something that you'll need to think about. Ground control points. What is the accuracy that you'll need? What is the absolute accuracy and the relative accuracy? So we can get maybe high relative accuracy using photogrammetry, but maybe we absolutely have to have GCPs to get absolute accuracy. Just an example of some state plane coordinate systems here. In Missouri, we've got three different state planes active. Illinois, there's two. Indiana, there's two. So you'll want to be aware of what your client needs or what the project needs. You want to be aware of where you're flying in order to pick the best coordinate system. So in terms of flight planning, again, there's going to be basic things. The area of interest that we're looking at. Geometric parameters, meaning the area that we want to fly, how that relates to how long our drone can fly, how far we'll go, so are we going to end up out of sight, things like that. And that's where our flight planning will come into play. We'll need to make sure that we maintain line of sight throughout our missions if we're flying in the US or Europe, for example. We'll need to make sure that we're not extending our flight beyond what our drone's battery system can handle. Things like this have to be taken into account. The logging and data acquisition systems are going to mostly be built into your drones. If you have a DIY drone or something like that, then you might need to think about that. But it is important to make sure when you go and do your flight that you actually, for example, start the data collection. I've started flights before where I forgot to push the start button on the LiDAR collector, and ended up getting several minutes of no data or several minutes of flight time where I didn't have any data. Thankfully, that didn't last too long, but that's something that we have to keep in mind. We learn from those mistakes and remember to not do that next time. The weather is obviously a big one, and that's something that's very hard to predict, of course. And so that's something where, especially if you're on a tight timeline, you'll want to be really aware of the weather. And if possible, use a UAV which is as weather resilient as possible. Now, most UAVs you're not going to be flying in the rain. Most you're not going to be flying in very high winds. But for example, if you can use a slightly larger UAV to fly in slightly higher winds, that's going to just give you that much extra flexibility when it comes to flying in bad weather. Or not flying in bad weather, but flying in difficult weather. The flight plan itself is going to be software specific. So if you're using Pix4D or if you're using the DJI Pilot 2 on a DJI drone, or if many drones have their own proprietary flight software, which is provided by the company. So whatever your software is, you'll sort of have to work out the details of that. But a typical software is going to allow you to create a polygon or some kind of flight area. It's going to often they will set up the flight plan for the drone automatically once you give it a polygon. The other thing that you want to think about here is your ground sampling distance, GSD, and what the resolution is of your camera and what your ground resolution needs to be. We'll talk more about that in a minute. So as I mentioned, obviously, if you're in controlled airspace, you'll need to do a LANCE request. Do you need to get special authorization? Drone zone authorization can take up to 90 days. That's if you don't have already an automatic LANCE request ability. So this is through the, for example, one of the Before You Fly apps. You can request automatic LANCE authorization for flying in controlled airspace up to that elevation, whatever the elevation is for the location that you're flying in. But let's say that you want to fly in an area which has a zero elevation. In that case, you're going to have to go through drone zone, and that authorization is going to take some time. You'll have to show to the FAA your safety considerations. And so this is all the things that you'll take into account. One of the things that's really important is, again, when you're flying, you need to be within your elevation restriction above ground level. So the elevation restrictions are always above ground level. And if you're in rough terrain or mountainous terrain, I've flown several areas where the terrain was very hilly. And so what I actually had to do was set my drone to fly terrain following. And some drones can do that, some cannot. You usually will have to download a DEM to the drone software. And again, the different softwares will do that differently. But that's something that you have to watch, especially if your drone doesn't have terrain following, that you're not going above your above ground level limits, your elevation limits, when you are flying from a higher place to a lower place. And the opposite is that you'll need to make sure that you're not flying into a mountain or a hill or a tree, even if the mountain is however high. You want to make sure that there's no towers on top of that. High lines, especially, often will run along a hill. So you'll want to make sure that there's no towers, no trees that your drone might run into if you don't have that terrain following, so that it clears those obstacles. So I mentioned GSD, ground sampling distance, earlier. The GSD is essentially your ground resolution. So a bigger GSD means lower spatial resolution, and this is of your final orthometric products. A smaller GSD means a higher spatial resolution. Of course, if you have a camera with a fixed resolution, a fixed pixel number of pixels in the rows and columns of the image, then your GSD is going to depend just on your camera's focal length. Then your GSD is basically just going to depend on your flight altitude. So in other words, your camera, you're flying your camera, and it already has a fixed resolution, it already has a fixed focal length. The only parameter left is your flight altitude. And so if you have a higher altitude, you'll have a lower ground sample distance, or a lower resolution, a larger ground sample distance. And if you fly at a lower elevation, then you'll have a higher resolution and a smaller ground sample distance in your final orthometric imagery. So this is a really important parameter to keep in mind, the ground sample distance, GSD, when you're doing your flight planning. Because let's say, for example, that you need to cover a large area, you might need to fly at a lower resolution, so you might need to fly at a higher elevation. If you really want high resolution, you'll have to fly at a lower elevation, but that could result in, you know, just a large amount of data to process that could take some time, be a problem. Or maybe you need to have high resolution, but there might be obstacles to your flight path that you need to take account for so that you don't run into them in order to fly at that low of an elevation. So again, just some of the things that you need to be thinking about when you're creating your mission plans. A couple of potential hazards that will come up are electromagnetic interference or loss of control. And this includes things like, this is an example from the Mavic 3E, and this is from the DJI's website. They point out that high voltage power lines, transmission stations, radar stations, cell phone base stations, broadcast towers, Wi-Fi hotspots can cause interference, electromagnetic interference with your controller. This is something that's really important to keep in mind. If you're flying around high lines, especially, I've done this before, you got to be very careful not to get too close in order not to have significant interference with your drone's radio communications to the radio control. If that happens, you can sometimes lose connection to your drone and lose control. Now, hopefully your drone has an automatic return to home function if that happens, but if not, then you need to be especially careful. So besides obstacles and electromagnetic interference, you can have people on the ground. You cannot operate legally over human beings without a category drone or a waiver. So this is something really important to keep in mind. You also can't operate over moving vehicles without a category drone or waiver. Are there locations, parts of your flight where you might lose visual line of sight? Do you need to, again, break your flight up into multiple pieces so that you maintain that visual line of sight? These are all things that you need to think about when you're doing flight planning. And checklists help to ensure that you do this. So I recommend that you create a checklist of all of these things, or, you know, whatever things are the most relevant for your flights that you're normally doing. If you know that you're often flying near high lines, make that a part of your checklist so that you remember every single time what you need to check before you fly. And this is just a good way to remember to do things. I'll be going through my list mentally and then I'll leave something out, what I thought was everything, but I'll have missed one or two details that were important, like turning on the LiDAR before you take off or something like that. So you don't want that to happen. Use checklists and that'll help make sure you cover all the requirements every single time that you fly and you'll be in good shape. All right, great. So now you're ready to start doing mission plans. Good luck doing that, and I will see you in the next video.